Okay guys, I hope you're doing good. So in this video, I'm going to respond to a few of the comments that you guys have made on my video, The Main Problem with Atheism. If you haven't seen that video yet, I recommend you check it out. It's only 10 minutes so that when you jump in on the conversation in the comment section, you have a better understanding of everything that has been said. Now I'm making this video a response mainly because I think it'll be more interesting if I respond through a video, but also because I want to record this conversation and document it. Because as many of you know, my YouTube channel has been shadow banned, and I've received many strikes over the past few years for spreading misinformation. So this channel could be taken down at any time. This video and all the comments could disappear overnight. So that's why I want to document it, because I think that our conversation has been very rich and respectful. So huge props to you guys. And yeah, that's really what has inspired me to continue this conversation and respond. So if you haven't subscribed to my Odyssey and BitChute channel, I recommend you do, because there's a lot of comment. Not a lot of comment. There's a lot of content that I upload there, which I cannot upload here on YouTube. So with that said, let's take a look at the first comment by Sandra Jackson. Okay, so she says that facts comes before knowledge. And she says this because in the previous video, I had talked about how the knowledge of God is a knowledge that is experienced, not learned factually, in a book. I guess she disagrees with me, essentially. Think about this for a moment. Everything that we know to be a fact today, once upon a time, wasn't a fact. You had to have people with courage. You had to have scientists who had faith, who believed, okay, and who basically took action, who basically went on a path of discovery, of experiencing, of experimenting to discover a truth. And then many other people followed and confirmed the discovery that they had made. And now it's a fact to us. Now we read it. Now we appreciate it. So facts, the way I see it, always comes in second place. Exploration, having faith, having the courage to basically experiment without having the facts, this always takes first place, okay? Experimentation and knowledge through experience without having any facts, okay? Exploration, discovery, persevering, having faith, believing, this always takes the forefront. And when you consider that human civilization is infinite, the things that we can discover and we are discovering is infinite. As human civilization continues to move forward, we're constantly discovering new things about the world, about science, about ourselves, our potentialities, etc. So at the forefront is always faith. Okay, it's always belief that there is more, that we can discover more. And facts comes in second place. The truest knowledge is always through experience. When you think about everything you learn in schools, sure, you learn a lot about scientific facts that have been already proven, but you truly learn when you carry out, when you experiment everything you theoretically learned. You don't really learn anything unless you do the practical aspect of it. And the same applies to the knowledge of God. You can learn anything you want in books. There's a lot of books that have been written about God, but we truly experience him. We truly get to know him through experience as we implement his teachings, his commandments. Just like Soren Kierkegaard said, the true knowledge of God is a knowledge that is experienced as we follow in his ways. The knowledge of God follows obedience to him, follows being in the truth, in his truth. Facts come before knowledge. If not in that order, what you have is either speculation, a belief, or just plain old delusion. I don't agree. I don't agree with what she says, because the most amazing things in life comes from us not having the facts, okay? Not understanding things, but rather committing to it anyways, right? The guy who invented the plane had a dream. He said, I want to fly. I believe we can fly.
I believe I can fly. I believe I can touch the sky.
Everybody called him deluded, but nevertheless, he didn't have the facts. He didn't have anything, but he committed to it. He believed, he had faith. He persevered. And eventually, through experimentation and a whole lot of failure, he invented the airplane. Okay? That's not exactly how the story goes, but you get my point. This belief that we have to first understand God in order to believe in Him is, in my opinion, very arrogant, you know, very arrogant, very egotistical, right? Which is a common belief in the West. We think so highly of the human mind, of intellect, to the point where we believe that if we can't understand something, then it doesn't exist. If we can't see something, it doesn't exist. What's lacking in Western society is humility, is the recognition that the human mind does not have the capacity to understand everything. You know what I'm saying? When it comes to things that pertain to this world, we don't have the capacity to understand a lot of things. And we have to believe, and we have to have faith, and we have to trust, and we have to experiment to discover truths. You know what I'm saying? How much more so when it comes to God, the infinite one? How can human mind, which is limited, contain the unlimited one, the infinite one, the ever abiding one, the everlasting one? It cannot. How can creation ever hope to understand the creator? You know, if I'm a painter, for example, and I make a painting, how can that painting ever understand me, the painter? It can't. If I'm a carpenter and I build a table, for example, that table can never grasp me. The human mind, which is limited, can never fully understand God. Okay. So the only thing we're left with, the only hope we have in growing in our knowledge of God is having faith. Okay. Having faith. And this was actually one of the main concerns by a lot of people in the comment section, right? Teo Skeptomai said, so this video actually suggests I first choose to believe something of which I am not convinced of in order to believe it. Wow. So it's very foreign to people, especially people in the West, this idea that the human mind is limited. You cannot understand something. You have to first commit to it in order to understand it. It's a very foreign concept because, you know, he's shocked. He says, wow, you want me to believe in something that I don't understand? And my answer was simply, you got it.
You got it. You got it. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? The journey of everlasting life throughout the eternal worlds of God is this journey of unlocking divine mysteries and unlocking the knowledge of God and appreciating His beauty. This is why we have been created, right? It's a never-ending journey towards perfection. But atheists want the answer now.
I want it now. Don't care how. I want it now.
I want to understand God now, then I'll commit. When that's, you know what I'm saying? It goes against the entire journey or system that God has created. Consider this. If we are truly sincere in our desire to discover God, discover if He is real or not, if He exists or not, you know, if He is, if there is such an entity that is all-powerful, the Almighty, the all-knowing, okay, He knows everything. The ancient one, the everlasting one, the infinite one, the most glorious one, the creator of the heavens and the earth and everything that lies between them, your creator, you know what I'm saying? The creator of this world, everything. If there is such a powerful, okay, glorious entity, shouldn't the proper posture, our proper posture, be that of humility when approaching this journey, approaching Him for answers? Shouldn't our default posture be that of humility, submissiveness, obedience, and trust? How do you approach a king? in this physical realm. Okay. Another human, just like yourself, who happens to have a crown, just some material wealth. How do you approach a king? How does a peasant approach a king? With humility, submissiveness, obedience, and trust, right? How much more so God, the king of all the worlds, okay? And this posture is what is lacking. This is what I talk about, okay? Humility, submissiveness, obedience, and trust, all of these four are lacking. They refuse to trust, okay? In divine scripture, in his divine manifestation, in God. They refuse to obey, okay? They refuse to be submissive, and they refuse to be humble. I must first, my limited human mind should first understand God, and I should become satisfied, and then I will obey and I will follow him, right? So this posture is lacking. I mean, when we consider the human condition, when we consider that we are creation and how insignificant we are when compared to the Creator, you gotta be humble.
Be humble. Holla. Sit holla. Down. Holla. Holla. Be humble.
You gotta have a humble posture. You gotta be submissive. You gotta obey and trust. You know, kind of like a student and a very knowledgeable teacher. If you're not humble, if a student is not humble, okay, and obedient to the teacher, you are unteachable. That teacher cannot teach you, okay? And in the same manner, if you refuse to obey, you refuse to trust, you refuse to be humble and submissive before God, the greatest teacher of all, then he can't teach you. You can't learn. You won't receive the evidences of his existence, okay? You won't be able to unlock the knowledge of God. Sandra goes on to say, how do you know any of what you are experiencing is actually God and not just what you perceive to be a God? Very good question. Very good question. You know, I agree with Sandra. We can never hope to and claim to have fully understood God or experienced him in his fullness. You know, in the Baha'i teachings, we learn one of the definitions of God is that unknowable essence of all essences. So basically, we can never understand him. He is too exalted for our limited human minds. In the long Baha'i obligatory prayer, there's a section where we read, too high art thou for the praise of those who are nigh unto thee to ascend unto the heaven of thy nearness, or for the birds of the hearts of them who are devoted to thee to attain to the door of thy gate. I testify that thou hast been sanctified above all attributes and holy above all names. Okay, so whatever names of God that we are familiar with, the Almighty, the All-Wise, the Most Powerful, the Everlasting, the Compassionate One, the Just One, all of these names of God, whatever we imagine, our understanding of those names, he is sanctified of all of that. He is holy above all of those names, all of those attributes, above our imagination. Our wildest imagination. The beloved master, Abdu'l-Bahá, said that the mystery of divinity is sanctified and purified from the comprehension of the beings. For all that comes to the imagination is that which man understands. And the power of the understanding of man does not embrace the reality of the divine essence. All that man is able to understand are the attributes of divinity, the radiance of which appears and is visible in worlds and souls. This also reminds me of a hidden word revealed by Baha'u'llah, where he says, O Son of Beauty, by my spirit and by my favor, by my mercy and by my beauty, all that I have revealed unto thee with the tongue of power and have written for thee with the pen of might hath been in accordance with thy capacity and understanding, not with my state and the melody of my voice. So everything we have been taught about God through religion and through his divine prophets and through scripture has really been revealed or taught to us according to our very limited capacity, not in accordance with God's true glory and God's true state. Okay. So again, 100% I agree with Sandra Jackson. But having said that, do I believe that we can grow in our knowledge of God and experience of God, however limited that may be? Yes, I do. I mean, we're taught throughout all the ages, throughout every religion, every divine prophet and scripture, we learn that this is what we have been created for. In the short obligatory prayer, we read, I bear witness, O my God, that thou hast created me to know thee and to worship thee. You know what I'm saying? So although God is unknowable in his essence, we have been created to grow in our knowledge of him, to unravel divine mysteries and appreciate his beauty throughout the eternal worlds of God. He wanted to share his glory and his beauty with creation. Therefore, he created us out of his love, has created us in his image, unlike anything else in nature, in creation. He has gifted us with this unique capacity, this unique opportunity to be able to reflect his divine perfections, his qualities. Okay, we've been created in his image. Okay, and as we begin to grow in these divine perfections, these spiritual virtues, we can experience a little bit of God within us. How do you know if what you are experiencing is actually God and not just what you perceive to be a God? Very good question, because as many of us know, there's a lot of people in this world who have false representations of God in their minds. So the way I see it is that I'm headed in the right direction when it comes to unlocking the knowledge of God and experiencing God within me the way he intended. The reason why I am certain that I am being led in the right direction is because I have certainty in the source of truth, the source of training, which happens to be the divine prophets of God, the divine manifestation of God. Okay, Christ, the Bab, Baha'u'llah, Muhammad, Krishna, Buddha, Zoroaster, etc. Okay, as many of you know, we have many sources of truth, of information, and sources of misinformation and falsehoods. Okay, just like the scamdemic, right? We had the fact checkers, the so-called health agencies who claimed to have the truth and nothing but the truth, and everything else they labeled as falsehoods. As many of you know, it happened to be the contrary. They were the pushers of all types of mistruths and falsehoods and hoaxes, while the illegitimate sources, the average Joe, the conspiracy theorist, etc., were speaking the truth. And now we see that. So it's important that you first identify a source of truth that you trust in, that you have no doubt is the source of truth. And it does take some research, some investigation. You have to put it to the test, right? And billions of people worldwide have come to this conclusion, to this certainty, that what these divine personages that have appeared in history, throughout history, the Christ, the Baha'u'llah, the Bab, Moses, Abraham, Zoroaster, Krishna, etc., that these are, in fact, they are who they have claimed to be, the representatives of God on earth. Okay, if God happens to truly be exalted above the human condition, if there can be no direct link between creator and creation, he has had to communicate with us through the human form. If we recognize these divine prophets to be truly beings that express, that have expressed the will of our creator, the will of God, then you have that certitude that the word of God, divine revelation, scripture, is the source of truth. And if we follow that, we implement its teachings, we implement the blueprint of life, then we're headed in the right direction. You know what I'm saying? You have no doubt. And what you experience and what you feel, what you learn is the best representation of God, the best knowledge of God, the best experience of God that we can acquire throughout this human journey. So it really boils down to, do you recognize these day springs of divine revelation of the will of God? Or do you not? You know, if you don't, then there's going to be a lot of confusion. You know what I'm saying? But let me just tell you this. Once you do your research, you put them to the test, you put the word of God to the test, their teachings, you analyze the behavior and the life that these divine prophets led, their person was the greatest proof of who they claimed to be. They were the embodiments, okay, like perfect mirrors of God, okay? They were the embodiments of purity, of chastity, of detachment from this world, of honesty, of love, of forgiveness, etc. The word that they revealed, the divine revelation that they channel, is the greatest evidence. The Bible, the Quran, the Baha'i teachings have revolutionized civilization. They have inspired the arts and the sciences of the world. We have algebra, we have mathematics, we have medicine, we have music, we have architecture because of divine revelation. Divine revelation has been and will continue to be the motive power of human civilization. You know, in the case of the Bab and Baha'u'llah, hundreds of thousands of verses they have revealed without premeditation, okay? And they don't go back and be like, you know what, I need to fix this or fix that. No, they just channeled the will of God, divine revelation. And if you dive deep into the word of God, into the revelation of the Bab and Baha'u'llah, it will become very evident to you that these words are not man-made, that these words come from the kingdom of heaven, that these words must come from your maker, your creator, because they contain this energy, these potentialities, this power, a frequency which is not of this world and which no human being, no mere human can produce, okay? A type of information which has the power and the ability to not only recreate the human heart, but revolutionize society and human civilization for thousands of years, carry forward human civilization for thousands of years. Okay, so moving on, she says, appealing to emotion just isn't a reliable, consistent, or logical method of arriving at truth, aside from the truth of what you feel. I cannot help that my mind will simply reject any idea that presents no good reason to warrant belief and does not hold under scrutiny. You are asking me to suspend logic, and I simply cannot do that. I never said that we should shut off our logical minds. I don't recommend that anybody should shut off their logic, their logical minds when it comes to God and religion. But what I will say is that we should let our hearts lead the way. We should let our spiritual intuition lead the way, not our minds. Okay, because why? Because we're in essence spiritual beings, not material, not physical. This is what all the divine prophets and all the religions throughout the ages have taught us, that we are in essence spiritual beings. We are limitless beings, that we have this higher, this divine, this spiritual nature, which is infinite. But we also have this physical, limited nature as well, the human nature. So here's a question that I ask you. When it comes to matters pertaining to divinity, to spirituality, to the infinite, would you rather your finite mind take the lead, or would you rather allow your spiritual reality take the lead, your heart, your spiritual vision, your spiritual intuition? And then allow your mind to follow. Don't shut it off, but allow it in second place. As you move forward in the path of faith, as you follow the divine teachings and strive to live the life, you reflect. You use your analytical mind, okay? Use your logical mind. Is this serving me? Is this helping me? Is it contributing to the betterment of society, to the betterment of the world? Am I being enabled to unlock divine mysteries, the knowledge of God? You know what I'm saying? So you don't shut it off, but you don't let your finite mind lead the way when it comes to matters pertaining to the infinite. You let your spiritual reality lead the way. But here's the problem. In the West, people have huge difficulty when it comes to putting their logical mind in the back seat. Why? Because spiritual education has been stripped away from the educational system, as many of you know, for many decades now. And so a lot of people, they don't even know that they are spiritual beings. They don't even know that they have a soul, and they haven't been trained to engage their spiritual faculties. They haven't been trained to use their hearts, their spiritual intuition, their spiritual vision. When you tell them to put their logical mind in the back seat and let your spirituality lead the way, they don't know what you're talking about. They think that you are asking them to fly blind.
Flying blind.
Because this is all they know. They've been trained just to use the logical mind their entire lives. This is not the case in, you know, the Middle East and many countries where spiritual education still exists, where they train children to use their spiritual faculties, their spiritual susceptibilities. In the Baha'i Hidden Words, Baha'u'llah says, "O man of two visions, close one eye and open the other. Close one to the world and all that is therein, and open the other to the hallowed beauty of the beloved." Okay, beloved with a big B, which basically means the divine, right? God, his divine manifestation. So if we want to understand and appreciate the divine, we must open our inner eye, our spiritual eye. So this implies that we do have a spiritual eye that we must strive to use in order to appreciate the beauty of God and grow in our knowledge of him. Okay. He says, "O man of two visions," not one, two visions. Are you taught that in these public schools? No, we're not. It also implies that first we must close our physical eye because it's distracting us. This is why when we meditate, when we pray, what do? We close our eyes, right? We create a space of silence so that our ears are not being engaged. Our eyes are not being engaged, right? We're not distracted. Our mind isn't being engaged by this world. One of the requisites of engaging our spiritual susceptibilities or faculties is to disengage, okay? Is to reduce, to minimize our five senses. And when we do that, we can tap into our spiritual powers. She says, "Doubt is the result of accepting a proposition on faith. And just why should anyone have to accept anything on faith if it's a fact?" Well, for a lot of people, I will say this: God and religion and all that, it's a fact. You know, we have sufficient evidence that God exists. You know, say, for instance, a biologist who dives deeper and deeper and sees how beautiful and how organized everything is. There must be an intelligent creator. This is not by chance. You know, this is not random. They become a believer. You know what I'm saying? So a lot of people, they have sufficient evidence that a God exists. Okay. But for those who don't, you use faith because the human mind, as we went over, is limited, very limited, and it cannot encompass the infinite. Okay. The infinite divine. And so in that case, when it comes to things that the human mind cannot understand and encompass, we have to engage faith. Sure. You know, when you can't understand something and you choose to have faith, initially you have a lot of doubt, right? But as you move forward, as you trust, as you have faith, as you believe, as you submit, as you obey, in the commandments, in the teachings, in the way of life, in the instructions of life, you will see evidences. You will become more certain. You will lose a lot of that doubt. And this has been my journey and the journey of a lot of religious people. All right, so to finish off The last paragraph, she says, they will then look for ways to further convince themselves. So they look to others to validate what they are desperately trying to accept as true. And if they do not get that validation, they will then do all in their power to convince the unbeliever. And if they are unsuccessful, then they will either get angry or suggest that it's some sort of deficiency in the understanding, logic, or character of the unbeliever who is looking at what theists present to them objectively, in which the believer is seemingly unable to do because they are so emotionally invested in what they believe and take it personally when someone else rejects it, and why often atheists are accused of being cold and arrogant. Okay, so where should I start? When it comes to me, for example, I don't get angry. You know, I don't push it on people. I don't try to look for ways to convince myself. I don't have any doubts. You know what I'm saying? I have been so convinced, okay, that to the point at this point in my life where I have zero doubts. You know what I'm saying? The only real thing, the most real thing is God, is my spiritual reality, is the divine manifestation of God, is His word. At this point in my life, everything else is fake. Everything else is an illusion. Everything is subjected to the changes and chances of life. The only thing that is solid is my spiritual reality and my connection with the Infinite One. That love I have for Him in my heart, this relationship that nobody can take away from me. So I have no doubts. And if you're like me, if you hit rock bottom, you know what I'm saying? You were suffering big time for many years. You turn to everything in this world. You turn to professionals. You turn to self-help books. You turn to a couple of vices and addictions, but nothing healed your pain. Okay, nothing solved or healed your traumas, your childhood traumas, etc. Your inflamed ego. Nothing worked for you. But then eventually you hit rock bottom, you crack, and through that crack, the light of the Lord comes in. You're forced to believe in that which your logical mind didn't allow you to. You know what I'm saying? I was just like you guys, right? Like most of you guys. I couldn't bring myself to believe in that invisible man upstairs. And I could never imagine the power latent in the Word of God, because it's words, it's pages, it's a book. I hated books, okay? I was trained to hate books because of the indoctrination camps and all the junk that they taught us. I hated books. So the last thing I could ever imagine is that these were magical words with the power to transform you and heal you. The healer of all thine ills is remembrance of me. Forget it not. Make my love thy treasure and cherish it, even as thy very sight and life. Thy name is my healing, O my God, and remembrance of thee is my remedy. God is sufficient unto me. He verily is the all-sufficing. In Him let the trusting trust. On and on and on, right? I had no idea that the Word of God carried a energy, a frequency, a power that could revolutionize my life. You know, but once I started, I don't have confirmation bias. I was not always a believer. I was a disbeliever, again, like a lot of you guys. But I was forced to, I ran out of options. I exhausted all worldly options. And I was forced to, through His mercy, it was a blessing, to turn towards Him and try it out. Okay, for once, try diving deep, okay, and following His commandments and striving to live the life. And the more I did that, the more, for the first time in my life, I started to heal on every level and transform on every level. So it's not confirmation bias at all. It's experimentation. It's a scientific model. Okay, you try your whole life, you try everything else. Try vices, addictions, entertainment, escaping from your problems. You try to fill the void with relationships, try to seek validation from other people. You know what I'm saying? You try everything, nothing works. You get worse and worse. You hit rock bottom, and then you're forced to believe because you have no other options. You know what I'm saying? So at this point in my life, the amount of benefit that I've received is so great, okay? Like nothing I have received from this a material world, that the amount of loyalty and faithfulness and reliance and trust I have in God, the true lover, is so great that nothing can swerve me away. I have so much certitude. I've witnessed the healing powers, the transformative powers of the Word of God. And you can truly witness its powers when you are sick, when you hit rock bottom. It's like a patient who is sick, who can prove the remedy of the physician. If you are not sick, you cannot prove the remedy. The remedy will have no effect on you. You know what I'm saying? And this is why, like myself, a lot of you who have hit rock bottom, you have been awakened. You ran out of options. You were in a way forced to believe in the last thing that you could bring yourself to believe in. And then as you trusted, you began to see results. You start to heal yourself. So at this point, if the entire world were to become disbelievers, based off of what I have experienced and what I have benefited from the love of God and His Word, nothing could swerve me away from His love. I pledge my allegiance to Him, to His Word, to His cause, to His divine manifestation, till the day I die, forever, forevermore. And then that we suggest that it's some sort of deficiency in the understanding, logic, or character of the unbeliever. I did share that with you guys, that I do believe that one of the major things that prevents unbelievers when it comes to recognizing God is their approach, their posture. They lack humility. They lack submissiveness, obedience, and trust. You know, there was one gentleman who said that, you know, if you blindly believe in things and you blindly trust things, then you're going to get scammed. You're going to get abused. And look, I understand that. We live in a world where everything has been hijacked and everybody is abusing everybody and taking advantage of you. But to put God, the embodiment of purity, of chastity, of mercy, of love, of compassion, of everything that is good, to put God in the same basket with criminals and scammers, what a huge mistake, guys. What a huge mistake. The one thing you should trust is your loving Father. You know what I'm saying? The one thing you should trust. And to put Him in the same basket and not trust Him because of a couple criminals and scammers, what a huge loss. You know what I'm saying? What a big mistake. When you're so in love with something, with a person, with God, whatever it may be, I'm in love with natural health, too, as many of you know. You speak about it freely with passion, okay? Speak about it freely. When you love something, it's at the tip of your tongue. You cannot help but to talk about it. And this is why I talk about natural health, why I talk about music sometimes. I love music, as many of you know. I studied music production back in the day. I'll talk about God, about spirituality, because I love it. It has benefited me so much. And naturally, I want to share it with other people. Our highest station as human beings is that of servitude. So naturally, we would want to help and serve other human beings. And so when I share God and the Baha'i faith with you know, you guys sometimes from time to time, I share it as I would a gift to a king, with humility, as I would a gift to a king. This is what we're taught. This is how we should share the faith. There is no anger. You know what I'm saying? There is no anger. If a person doesn't accept a truth, something that will benefit them, I don't get angry. It's their loss. If anything, I might feel a little bit sorry for them. But everybody has the right to choose what they want to, right? Everybody has the right to choose what they want to. So if you don't want to go the alternative route and cure yourself of these so-called incurable diseases using natural methods, all of the cures which we have and they've banned, and they've made illegal, that's fine. You can go down the path of chemotherapy and radiation and drug therapy and shorten your lifespan and get depopulated. That's your choice, right? So in the same manner, if you choose not to turn and recognize your creator and follow his teachings, which will benefit you and benefit society, that's completely up to you as well. You want to turn to everything that you've learned in the public schools, all of the perversion and ungodliness that has been taught to you in schools so that they can become your gods and enslave you and control you and all that kind of stuff, by all means. You know, if you think ungodliness is going to benefit society, by all means, go in that direction, right? Nobody's stopping you. It's your choice. You know, another thought that comes to my mind, which we learn about in divine scripture, we learn about in religion and every single one of his divinely revealed books, is that God never reveals himself in his full glory. His divine prophets, his divine messengers have never revealed themselves in their full glory. They never made it obvious, okay? Because if they made it obvious, then everybody would bow down to the Lord. Everybody would become believers right away. You know, it would be so obvious that they would become believers and follow him and become submissive and obey him. And this goes contrary to the free will that God has given us, unique to us as human beings. Everything in nature, all animals are submissive to the laws of nature, to his will. They don't have free will. We have been given free will. And this is another thing we learn in scripture, because God wants to discern and identify the believers from the disbelievers, the pure in heart, those whose hearts are attracted to heaven, to spirituality, to God, and those hearts who are attached to this world, essentially, and everything that pertains to it. So if he makes himself, if he reveals himself in his full glory and makes it so obvious, it renders free will useless. You know what I'm saying? Everybody's going to bow down because it's so obvious, right? His majesty, his power. And this is why when we study religion, we study the every single divine prophet, Christ, Muhammad, the Bab, Baha'u'llah, Abraham, Moses, etc., we see that every single one of them lived a life of poverty, lived a life of detachment, humility. Outwardly, they appeared to be downtrodden. They appeared to be very weak, but inwardly, they had this majestic spiritual power, which transformed the human heart, which transformed human civilization. You know what I'm saying? So they are wrapped in a myriad veils. They arrive on this planet wrapped in a myriad veils. The most hidden light in the most hidden pavilion, we read in the Baha'i long healing prayer. So I thought I'd mention that as well, because, you know, a lot of atheists, a lot of human beings, they expect that understanding God would be a simple thing. You know, it should be logical. It should be simple. It should be obvious. But this is also not the case. It goes contrary to divine design. God never manifests himself. His divine prophets never manifest themselves in their full glory because they don't want everybody to recognize them. Okay, they don't. One of the purposes of these divine prophets has always been to filter between the pure in heart and the impure, from those who are attracted to divinity and those who are attracted to this world. Okay, there's a filtration that takes place. We read this in the Bible, in the history of every religion, how father and son were separated. You know, when the divine prophet arrives, they were tested and they were separated, best friends, husband and wife, father and son. You think they couldn't manifest themselves to a point where all of these crooks and criminals and tyrants would recognize them? Of course they could, but they chose not to. So it's important to understand that intentionally he has wrapped himself in a myriad veils, okay? Intentionally. It's not going to be simple for you and for a lot of people to recognize God. It's not going to be logical, and it's by design. Okay, it's by design. You have to make a lot of effort. You have to become purified. A lot of people, it's going to be through suffering and pain. The more the soil is plowed, the more fertile it becomes for the seed of the Lord. Okay, the more you put gold in fire, the more it is purified from its impurities. You know how I talked about how humility is lacking in the West, and a lot of people, and a lot of atheists, and it is suffering when you reach rock bottom. Through suffering, we become humble and ready and submissive to recognize God. You know what I'm saying? So sometimes, you know, as you go through a whole lot of suffering, you become more prepared and more worthy and more ready to recognize God. It's a journey. It's not going to be easy. When you think about all of the beautiful things of life, nothing that's worth anything comes easy. How much more so the recognition of the Lord? How much more so the recognition of your Maker and connecting with that infinite source of unconditional, perfect love? Okay? How much more so? Because this connection eventually leads to eternal life as we die to the human condition and are recreated in His incorruptible qualities. We become more like Him. Like seeketh like and taketh pleasure in the company of its kind. As we die to human imperfections and become more godlike, essentially, we reflect more of His divine perfections, we become incorruptible. Essentially, this is what we learn in divine scripture. So you would think that eternal life would not come easy. You know what I'm saying? It's not going to be so obvious and so logical. You have to work for it. You have to suffer for it. It's the journey of life, essentially. So I thought I'd mention that as well. So that's really it, guys. I am going to leave it at that because already the video is too long. If you enjoyed this, you want me to answer to more of your comments, let me know and I'll make another video. But I'm going to leave it at that. Let me know what you guys think in the comments section, and I'll see you guys in the next video.